Hello, I'm Dr. Hillel Chiel.
And I'm Dr. Jeffrey Gill.
We would like to introduce you to the study of brain and behavior in the Chiel Laboratory. Animals must continuously adjust their behavior in response to complex and changing conditions. Most of their behavioral adjustments enhance their ability to survive and reproduce, and this ability is referred to as adaptive behavior. What are the mechanisms that underlie adaptive behavior? Although this is a challenging question, it is likely to lead to a better understanding of how humans can adjust to changing conditions. Furthermore, understanding adaptive behavior may also suggest how to create devices that can help humans cope with a disease, such as a smart prosthetic hand to replace a damaged hand, or a brain-computer interface that might allow a stroke patient to communicate. Finally, a deeper understanding of adaptive behavior could lead to the creation of autonomous, flexible, biologically inspired robots that could function like animals or humans in complex natural environments. Adaptive behavior emerges from an ongoing interaction between the nervous system, the body which senses the environment and provides ongoing feedback to the nervous system, and the environment in which an animal is situated. Although understanding the mechanisms of adaptive behavior is a daunting challenge, because one needs to study the brain, the body, and their interactions with one another and the environment, it is clearly worth the effort. An approach to addressing this challenging problem is to choose an experimentally tractable system that allows one to monitor and manipulate all of these components.
That has been the rationale for studying the marine mollusk Aplysia californica. The animal is capable of various forms of adaptive behavior that are found in many other animals, including feeding, avoiding predators, and mating. The animal is very robust because it lives in tide pools such as these near the shoreline, and as a consequence, when the tide goes out, it is exposed to changes in temperature, how salty the water is, the amount of light, and it is exposed to moving waves, which can sometimes be very strong. Here is an aplysia within a tide pool in its natural habitat. As a consequence of aplysia's robustness, it is possible to study its behavior in captivity. In particular, we have focused on one of the animal's favorite behaviors, feeding. Here we see the animal's grasper attempting to pull food in during feeding. The behavior is controlled by the feeding musculature, also called the buccal mass. An aspect of aplysia's feeding behavior that makes it particularly interesting is that the animal feeds on a very wide variety of different seaweeds that have very different shapes and toughness. The difference in mechanical properties requires that the animal rapidly adjust its behavior to cope with changes in food during feeding, just as our teeth, tongue, and jaw muscles rapidly adjust while we eat. These seaweeds can take various forms. For example, sea lettuce, seen here, also known as ulva, generally grows in sheets. Gracilaria has a long, thin, highly branched structure. Sea grapes, also known as Botryocladia, have a bulbous grape-like structure at their tips. Changes in the texture, toughness, and thickness of seaweed requires the animal to make moment-to-moment adjustments as it feeds.
Although the adaptive behavior of aplysia is similar to that seen in more complex animals and in humans, its nervous system is much easier to analyze. In the entire nervous system, there are only about 20,000 neurons organized into discrete collections called ganglia. Each of these ganglia are dedicated to the sensing and control of particular parts of the animal. For example, the abdominal ganglion controls many important functions such as heartbeat and components of the body responsible for the animal's breathing behavior, including respiratory pumping of water over the gill and control of the siphon. The pedal pleural ganglia play important roles in controlling locomotion and other movements of the head of the animal. The buccal ganglia control the feeding apparatus, the buccal mass. The cerebral ganglia controls the head and lips, and is the one ganglion that receives input from all the other ganglia, and thus is likely to provide overall control signals that allow the animal to choose among different behaviors as the environment changes. The nervous system is unusually suitable for analysis, which was the reason that investigators were initially attracted to study the animal. The neurons are large, ranging from about 30 microns in diameter, which is about three times the thickness of a human hair, to as large as a millimeter in diameter in full-grown animals. The largest neurons are visible without magnification. The largest feature of the neurons are their cell bodies, called the soma, and are generally orange in color, making it much easier to see them. In general, the cell bodies are near the decision point for the neuron, that is, the place at which the neuron first initiates the signal that it sends to other neurons. The cell bodies are themselves capable of generating the signal called the action potential, and because the cells are so large, electrical currents travel quickly throughout the cell. Therefore, we can use electrodes to excite the neurons electrically, either increasing the output of an entire neuron or inhibiting it and blocking its entire output. This is very unlike neurons in insects and crustacea, where the cell body is generally not excitable and is not near the decision point for the neuron. Here shown is a schematic diagram of the collection of nerve cells responsible for controlling feeding behavior, the buccal ganglion. On the left side, the tissue covering the neurons, called the sheath, has been removed so that you can see individual pigmented cell bodies. In addition, you can also see a glass microelectrode that has been placed within a nerve cell, making it possible to record its electrical properties and control them. On the right-hand side, the sheath has not been removed, and you can see that an extracellular suction electrode has been applied to one of the nerves of the ganglion. This makes it possible to look at the activity of all the neurons that send messages through this nerve. On either side, near the middle, there are extracellular glass microelectrodes which can stimulate and record from cells without touching them, even through the sheath. Moreover, in aplysia, neurons can be uniquely identified and given specific names because the inputs they receive, the outputs they generate, their location in the ganglion, and their electrical properties are very similar across animals. The ability to identify neurons makes it possible to work out details of neural circuitry, as well as to understand the sensory inputs and motor outputs of the circuit. Therefore, it is possible to create maps of the neurons in the buccal ganglion showing their specific names, for example, B3 or B8. On the left, we see the profiles of the individual identified neurons through the sheath. On the right-hand side, we see a map of the individual identified neurons.
Since our overall goal is to understand the mechanisms of adaptive behavior, we need to understand the nervous system's function within the animal's body during behavior. How its muscles respond to neural signals and how the muscles are organized to generate movements are therefore essential to understand. The general term for the study of the structures that generate animal behavior is biomechanics, and understanding how we move, handle objects, or manipulate things in the world requires a careful study of human biomechanics. Studying the same subject in the slug is challenging because, like our tongues, the trunks of elephants, or the tentacles of a squid, the slug is made entirely of soft materials, such as muscle and cartilage, that both generate force and serve as the structure. The advantage of this organization for the animal's behavior is that the range of movements the animal can make is much greater than what is possible for an animal that can only move parts of its body around joints. To understand soft biomechanics, we have used novel techniques. One approach we used was to shine light through the bodies of very young slugs. Here we see a video of a young slug feeding. Since the slug body is translucent when a slug is young, we could see outlines of the feeding musculature, that is the buccal mass, from the side, here on the left, and from the top, here on the right, as the animal feeds. You can see that the buccal mass undergoes a sequence of shape changes as the animal grasps and swallows food. What is happening inside the buccal mass? To understand this question, we used another technique, magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI, to peer inside the middle of the animal during feeding. Since MRI does not require us to keep the slug still or to change its behavior in any way, we could see what the slug was doing without altering its feeding movements. As you can see in the video, looking right through the middle of the animal, the overall shape of the buccal mass is changing because the internal structures are moving to grasp seaweed and to pull it back into the animal's esophagus and gut. Here we have outlined both the seaweed and the animal's buccal mass as it swallows the seaweed, moving it from right to left. Using this information, we were able to create a three-dimensional model of the movements of the muscles of the buccal mass during biting, swallowing, and rejection behaviors. A movie of a biting model shows that muscles push the central grasper forward. Induce it to close on the food, and then pull the food into the animal. Recently, a talented student created this three-dimensional animation of the buccal mass in the actual process of swallowing, as shown here.
Finally, because we want to understand the mechanisms of adaptive behavior, we do whatever we can to study the activity of neurons in the feeding circuits and the movements of the buccal mass during natural behavior in the intact animal. This video shows an animal attempting to feed on an artificial stimulus that requires very high forces, and we can watch what the animal does while also recording activity on all the key nerves that control the feeding apparatus. The research we have done has led to a variety of exciting discoveries. What makes science so much fun is that each discovery raises still more questions, so we are in the midst of projects that will allow us to further understand how adaptive behavior works. Here is a brief list summarizing some of our major discoveries and current projects in the laboratory. We've analyzed the neuromechanics of multifunctional feeding behavior. We've created a series of increasingly realistic neuromechanical models of feeding. We have shown that sensory feedback can shape variability during motor control. We have determined the neuromechanical mechanisms that underlie robustness in response to mechanical loading. We have demonstrated that a single muscle can have multiple distinct functions. In collaboration with colleagues, we've developed biologically inspired and biohybrid robots. We have shown that changes in local synaptic connections can lead to changes in global behavior. We have developed novel methods for inhibiting and activating neurons. We have developed software tools that allow behavior and neural activity to be analyzed together. Finally, we have developed an ecologically balanced approach to aquarium ecology. You can learn more about these projects by watching the videos that are posted on this channel. Thank you so much for your attention.